Hello and welcome to this edition of Political Capital, the show where Delhi meets Dalal Street. I'm Vivek Law. Narendra Modi's resounding victory in the 2014 general elections have helped the markets continue on a tearaway rally. To decode where the market is headed, joining me now is one of India's most closely watched market gurus, Ridham Desai of Morgan Stanley. Thanks very much, Ridham, for joining me here. When we last spoke, which was back in September, Ridham, I remember you had just lowered your forecast. India didn't seem like the place it is today. In fact, it's ironical that these 6 months have, or 8 months have actually seen such a dramatic shift, isn't it? Is this a Modi rally, you think, over the last few months, or do you believe the whole universe conspired in favor of us?
Yeah, it's good to be back, Vivek. Indeed, a lot of things went into India's favor. I think emerging markets kind of bottomed out at the same time. I think there was a lot of policy action that took place in India, most notably the ban on gold imports, as well as the very successful FCNR deposit issuance by the RBI. And then, of course, in December, we had those state election results. And since then, the market's confidence that the country will produce a strong mandate has been growing. But I think what happened on last Friday was completely astounding. The quality and the size of the mandate goes beyond anybody's expectations. And clearly, the market is very excited about what this can mean for India's macro. Mind you, we've not seen such a mandate since 1984. So it's almost been 30 years. It's the first time a non-Congress government has got an absolute majority. So the quality and the size of the mandate is very unique as far as the stock market is concerned. And in the stock market's living memory, it has really not seen such a thing. So if you analyze the mandate, we've seen voting which has crossed caste barriers, religion barriers. It has actually, I think, humbled a lot of political pundits in the way the Indian electorate has voted. I think the resounding message here is that the electorate wants growth and development. And if that is what the government is going to deliver, then obviously the stock markets are justified in their excitement.
Is that why you've called it India delivers a political tsunami in your most recent report, Ridham?
Yes, indeed. In fact, Vivek, I'll just step back a little, you know, just prior to this. In fact, a few days ago, we had written a report called The Next India, in which we outlined what we thought was the coming 10-year structural story. It was actually a very large report. Normally, we don't end up writing such large reports with a glossy front page. And the thesis or the theme of the report was that India is coming out of a cyclical downturn, and investors be reminded that this is still the best structural story, or one of the best structural stories in the world, led by very strong demographics, probably an improvement in productivity from low levels, a cyclical factor, and also a strong export story that's emerging out of it. So that, in our view, was going to lead to reasonably good GDP growth, 6.75% over the next 10 years, and somewhere around 13 to 14% CAGR in share prices. So we wrote that report, not anticipating this type of an election result. So as we call this report, the one that you refer to, we call it the trigger for next India. So we think that this election mandate will, in all probability, act as a trigger for this next India that we have been talking about, you know, to actually roll out. So there's a good now, I think, greater conviction and higher probability that India gets that next India, which is, you know, higher real GDP growth and higher stock market returns in the coming several years.
Just before I go into greater detail about your most recent report, Ridham, just one question. How much, according to you, was the kind of money that we've continued to see coming in from FIIs in the last, even the last 6-8 months? How much of it do you believe is because of the impending election result that they saw or foresaw, let's put it that way? And how much of it has been because suddenly India in relative terms to its peers over the last 8 months for reason that you talked about in terms of our macros getting better? How much of it is because of that? Any assessment?
You know, Vivek, if you recall, we had discussed this in the past as well, that India is a good house in a bad neighborhood. That on a relative basis, India is still offering a better story, and it doesn't seem to be structurally impaired. At worst, it is cyclically impaired. It's a deep cyclical downturn, but it's still cyclical compared to a lot of its peer group where there are structural problems. So yes, of course, I think part of this money flow has to do with the fact that investors out there started to believe that India's cycle has turned. But if you just look at the gap between the flows that India has got and its peer group has lost, that gap I don't think can be explained by a mere cyclical turnaround. So for sure, I think there have been investors out there who have probably bet that India will produce a strong election result, and you know, started putting money to work on the basis of the state election results and the pre-poll surveys that followed, and then, of course, the exit polls. So I think a fair bit of money should have been based on that. It's hard to make the split because both the stories were simultaneously in play. But I think the latter part also played a very strong role in differentiating India from the rest of its peer group.
Coming back to your most recent report, which has been written after those dramatic election results of 16th, Ridham, you mentioned there that you have assumed a greater chance of a reform agenda, even though clarity on this will emerge in the ensuing weeks. What kind of a clarity, or what would be those two or three or four things that you would be looking out for over the next few weeks?
Yeah, Vivek, see, the reason for us to make that assumption is because I think that's what the electorate has given this mandate for. So it will not be lost upon the political class precisely why they have received the mandate that they have received. Young India is aspirational, and they are seeking better development and growth. So I think it becomes imperative for the political class to make that its prime focus. So there's logic in making that assumption. I think the three things that you should be looking for in the coming weeks. First is a de-anchoring of India's high inflation rate. So if I were to ascribe one factor to why inflation has been as high as it has been for the past 3 or 4 years, I think it's because of very large government consumption expenditure, which is coming in the form, mainly in the form of subsidies and the wage program. So I think we need to see concrete steps from the government to curtail subsidies, even curtail the wage program, and if not curtail it, then at least make it more productive, i.e. convert the wage program into something that results into output, into production, rather than just supporting wages for rural India. That's the first thing. The second thing that I think we should be looking forward to is measures to unlock capital productivity. See, if you look at the incremental capital output ratio, which is a measure of capital productivity for the economy as a whole, it has halved in the last 5 years. So the output generation for every unit of capital that we are putting into the economy is about half its historical average. Now, the reasons are well known for it. They include the fact that GDP is operating below potential, but mostly it's to do with a plethora of projects that are either complete or half complete, but are not generating any output. And, you know, these are well-publicized reasons, so I'm not going to go into details. But the government needs to urgently take steps to ensure that these projects either get completed and start generating output, or if they have been already completed, then they start generating output. I think that will go a long way in reviving growth, in lifting capitalization, and lifting the profitability of the corporate sector. Because mind you, until that is done, you know, currently net margins for corporate India are at 7% and return on equities is a cycle low. That's not the level at which corporate India will start putting new capex to work. So you have to revive that in order to get new capex. And the third thing is to focus on deleveraging the private sector and or recapping the SOE banks. So one of the two or both ideally should be done, because that will then set the stage for a new credit cycle. See, right now the private sector is sitting on all-time high leverage, and the banking sector is maxed out on its LD ratio. So the deposit growth needs to rise, and the loan growth needs to come down for the LD ratio to go up, down, or the private sector needs to have lesser debt on its balance sheet. If real rates become positive and stay there because inflation has come down, then deposit growth will revive. And if you can delever the private sector, then you will get a revival in loan growth. So I think these are the three most important measures I see from a macro perspective that will go a long way in reviving the economy and keeping the market interested.
Ridham, you and your colleagues have called these election results an inflection point for India's story. If you were to extrapolate that to the markets, to the stock markets, how would you explain it to our viewers? You have in the past given targets. I haven't seen in this report you revising your forecast. How would you extrapolate this inflection point, the strong growth? In fact, your colleague Chetan Iyer, who's co-written this report with you, has also talked about the fact that even your GDP estimate for QE F16 is being increased significantly from 6.2 to 6.8%. So from a market point, could you explain, if all of this were to happen, the reforms that you've talked of, and I'll just come back to those reforms in a bit. If all of this were to happen, from the market point of view, where do you see these markets?
Yeah, see, Vivek, ultimately, macro growth will translate into earnings growth. So what's been plaguing the market over the last 3 or 4 years is declining profitability of corporate India, which is that we've really not had any earnings growth. And without earnings growth, equities can't perform. So what equities need is a revival in earnings growth. I think ordinarily, even without this election result, we were looking for a trough in the profit cycle. And over the next 2 or 3 years, our reckoning was that the profit cycle would have turned. Why is that? That's because the share of wages in GDP have hit a high point relative to the share of profits. This is very contrasting with the situation that we had in the middle of the last decade, somewhere around 2005-2006, when the share of wages had hit a low point relative to the share of profits. And indeed, at that time, we had penned a note called the coming wage inflation. We had argued that India's socialistic structure will not allow for this situation to persist, and there will be a response from the political class to lift the share of wages in GDP. We got NAREGA, and what ensued was a sharp increase in wages persistent over almost 8 years. And at the end of this 8-year period, we have now got exactly the opposite situation, which is that the share of profits are at a low point relative to the share of wages. We see this reversing over the next 2 or 3 years. And I think you will get a cycle where the share of profits will gain, which is what stock prices need. Stock prices need rising share of profits in GDP at the macro level. And that's how it all translates into greater share of profits. Now with this type of mandate in the pipeline, the chances are that this will happen faster than what would have ordinarily happened. So if it had taken, say, 3 years, with this mandate, there's a chance that it can happen in the next 6 quarters. So it can happen at double the pace. And we could see a revival in profit share of GDP, which will then drive up share prices. Of course, part of this, the market has already started to assume, as it usually does. Markets look forward and anticipate a turn in the future. And share prices are being bid higher. So that's how you actually translate a better macro environment, better policy environment into share market returns. So I don't know if that explains what you were looking for, but this is how the translation will take place. And regarding our targets, we have some targets. We put the index target for the next 12 months at 26,300, which would appear to be a modest upside from current levels. And the reason for that, I think, is that large cap valuations are not cheap. You know, markets are quite rich. However, there is also a bull case that we have painted, which I think is going to depend on how quickly we get a policy response from the government. We're not really in a position right now to speculate on that. We can see that there will be a policy response, but if it is very quick and if it is in line with what the market needs, then our bull case argues for 31,000 on the index. So there will be a lot more upside. At these levels, naturally, you know, I think the mid caps look far more attractive than the large caps. So I would reckon that there would be more upside on the mid caps than the large caps. If the government rolls out policy in an earnest fashion, then even large caps will deliver better than what our current forecasted returns are.
When you say how quick the government's response will be, Ridham, what is a reasonable period? I know that people on the street perhaps expect him to do magic from day one. Then there are others who are talking of 100 days, etc. But what would be a more reasonable timeline that you would look at for things to start moving and policy announcements to start coming in?
I think it'll be reasonable to expect it to happen over the next 4 quarters. I think it has to be taken step by step. Not everything can be done on day one. In my view, the urgent fixing is on the fiscal side. So you have to start fixing the fiscal deficit because that is crucial to de-anchoring inflation. I think the central bank needs a little bit of help. The central bank is trying to bring down inflation expectations by keeping rates high. And if the government can unwind its fiscal consumption expenditure, it will help the situation, and that it will set the stage for lower interest rates next year, which will then help the economy and it will help everybody in the system. So I think that's something that we should see as early as late June or early July when the budget comes out. And hopefully we get that type of fiscal focus, which is crucial to de-pegging inflation. Mind you, it brings a little bit of negative news on growth in the short run, but the market may have appetite to digest that if it sees that there is a serious intention to bring down inflation. Then as you follow through with the other moves, especially on capital productivity, of unlocking all these projects that are stuck, of doing things that will help companies lift their capacity utilization, I think those things can follow in the ensuing months. So I would say, a reasonable time frame for a rollout is the next 4 quarters.
In fact, you have outlined that perhaps one of the quick things that can be done is improving the business environment. Is it your view that even if these things are done, which don't need legislation, which can actually happen from day one in that sense, kickstart projects, put in place proper teams, which can actually drive, that would be enough of a signal for someone like you that this government means business?
No, in fact, Vivek, I'd say one more thing actually, even before that, is really what type of team takes charge. We should have that information the next 3 or 4 days when the Prime Minister and his cabinet get sworn in and his team of advisors get appointed. I think it's important. It's important to see the type of people who are going to run the affairs. Ultimately, the team that is going to execute is crucial, and therefore we will really know what type of drive there is in this government. So even before you take any executive decision, the very decision that will build the team around Mr. Narendra Modi, I think, will be also important input. And then, as you rightly point out, there are some low-hanging fruit with respect to reviving the business environment. I think there's a large-scale expectation that that will happen. And clearly, that's the risk. The risk is that expectations are very high. Of course, it doesn't mean that things will be bad, but those expectations have to be met. And if they are met, then I think we're on our way. If they are not met, then there will be some room for disappointment as far as share prices are concerned. The real economy may not matter at that stage, but share prices could get disappointed. So we have to keep a watch on that because of where expectations are.
What is the kind of team you would like to see? I'm not asking you for names. I know that's a bit tricky. But, we are already hearing, for example, that he wants to have a very small cabinet. He wants to bring in a fair number of technocrats. He wants to have a mix of youth and experience. Is that the right direction, according to you?
Yeah, actually, Vivek, that's well summarized. And I'll add one more point to that, is you need to empower the bureaucracy. I think that's the success story in Gujarat, is that the bureaucrat is empowered. It's the bureaucrat in the country who actually takes care of execution. He's the guy who moves the files forward. And if he feels a sense of empowerment, then I think you will see a lot more action happening. I think there should be a lot of emphasis on single window clearances, which is in the gone by 5 years, I think we've spent a lot of time creating multiple windows of clearances, which obviously leads to a slowdown in approvals. So I think these are the couple of things that add to the very right points that you point out, which is you want a mix of experience and youth, you want a mix of technocrats and politicians, you want to see bureaucrats getting empowered and more emphasis on single window clearances for various actions that the government needs to undertake.
And do you believe that from whatever information that you have, Ridham, whether it's your own research or whether it's the conversations that you have with a plethora of corporates, do you believe that on these terms at least, or on these parameters that we are talking about, the Gujarat model has worked?
No, I think that is the evidence from Gujarat. That is how the conversations around Gujarat are leading us to. So I would hope that it gets replicated in Delhi. So for Delhi, I think it is still a little bit of hope rather than actually knowing what will happen. Over the next few days or next several days, I think we will know how matters are carried forward in Delhi as well. But if Gujarat is the experience to go by, then I think that's what one's expectation should be about Delhi as well.
Ridham, talking about what an investor should do now, you have articulated a shift in the portfolio. Can you take our viewers through that? What are you looking at now in terms of your portfolio construct? What are you advising?
Yes, Vivek. In fact, we've been adding cyclicals for the past few months, and I would emphasize that further. I think as we get closer to a cyclical recovery, cyclicals are likely to outperform defensives, if I may use that term, to define stuff that is not as sensitive to economic growth. I think cyclicals will do a lot better. We still endure an allergy to high beta. I know high beta is doing very well right now, but that's not a good portfolio strategy. High beta does well in short cycles. In the long run, stocks with low beta tend to do a lot better. And there are cyclicals with low beta as well. So I think what investors need to focus on is good quality cyclicals that will benefit from an economic recovery, which are trading at reasonable valuations, and that should be the portfolio strategy. We find this in sectors like energy, sectors like materials, even the banks, the consumer discretionary sector. So I think you can pick up stocks from each of these sectors to build a portfolio with a one-year view. If you're looking at it from a longer term perspective, I think you want to wait as far as consumer staples is concerned, because that sector, I think, is likely to face a double whammy. It is trading at near all-time high valuations with near all-time high net margins. So I think both of these will reverse in the course of the next few months, and this sector could underperform the market for a considerable length of time until these adjustments are completed. In contrast, I think technology is still an opportunity. That sector has performed very poorly since March. And unless we get signals that US growth is faltering, I think tech stocks will come back. So, you know, amongst the defensives, I think technology looks better than staples. But otherwise, I think the cyclical sectors are really where you want to buy with a 12-month view.
My final question, Ridham, I remember a while ago you had given the forecast of 30,000. And at that time, everybody had this, you know, unbelievable look and said, is he for real? Do you believe now that we've, you know, hit 25,000 and now suddenly I find everyone talking about 30,000 as if it were going to happen tomorrow or day after? Do you stand vindicated, you feel?
No. I don't think these point forecasts mean much, actually, to anybody. You know, ultimately, you have to make returns in your portfolio. So there's really no merit in making accurate index forecasts. I get a lot of them wrong as well. I can get a few of them right, and that's part of the game. But there's one point I'd like to make here, which is that in our Next India report, yes, the magnum opus, as I call it, we have ventured to make a forecast on the Sensex. And that is somewhere in the region of 75,000 by 2025. So maybe that's the one that we'll test next time around.
75,000.
Of course, it's a long way to go.
By 2025.
But that's in the next 10 years, which is basically the market compounds at about 13% from current levels. It's not an outrageous level, mind you, Vivek. It's not an outrageous level. It's a very simple, straightforward 13% CAGR. And a lot of people will think that's a very conservative level to forecast. given the mood in the market today, I think a lot of people will be thinking that equities will do a lot better than that, and maybe they do. But I think the long-term outlook for equities looks very encouraging, and especially for retail investors who are heavily underweight equities, I think it's time for them to make this allocation shift in their portfolios away from real assets into equities. And in fact, I think that they will do that. And you know, if I may share one more data point that we have forecasted, which is that over the next 10 years, we expect Indian retail investors to pump as much as $250 billion into Indian equities. And just to put into context, that is 50% more than what foreign investors have brought home here over the past 20 years. So I think this is the decade of the Indian domestic investor, and it's all about to start now.
I keenly await that report of yours, Ridham, and I do hope that irrespective of where we are, we do get to speak to each other 10 years from now. Thank you very much for joining me today.
Thank you, Vivek. Thank you.